action of a government missionary to go look through or examine carefully a place, area, person, object, etc. Which means anything under the sky you can go and search in order to find something concealed or for the purpose of discovering evidence of a crime. So this is how search has been, search is generally defined. There are a lot of law definitions for search which may vary from the current definition that is being given in this one. But almost broadly it means that to go and inspect an area or examine an area. That is the area or anything for that matter. Even a person or a vehicle or a premises can also be done, but it should be done under the proper and valid authority of law. Now, there are two different concepts here, inspection and search. Inspection, I think at least for the central VAT is a new concept, I'm not sure about the state VAT. Inspection is a softer version of search, that's it. It's assumed that in inspection you don't do intrusive search. You go to this also has to be under the written authority of a joint commissioner, rank officer. Okay, there's no problem, they have to go into it, they just have to go there, ask for the record, see it then and there. Probably it has been kept as a alibi to go and see a record without a prior notice. That must be the only reason for it. This idea is that you don't do intrusive search by doing a bureau, you don't open a bureau, you don't break open an almera, you don't do all that kind of power opening where you do in, where you're authorized to do it in search. So inspection is something that is a very softer version of search, and a joint commissioner rank officer can authorize you to do a search. Search can be, or an inspection can be conducted for one of these four purposes. It's like suppressed any transaction of supply, suppressed stock of goods in hand, claim wrong sendback credit, or sorry, input tax credit, or contravened any provisions of the act. I think the last will be enough to do any, include anything in this whole thing actually, okay? Now, this author, where can you do an inspection particularly? Inspection can be done in a place of business of a taxable person. It can be done in a place of business of a person engaged in goods transportation, whether or not he is registered. And it can be done in a place of business of a owner of a or an operator of a warehouse, godown, and all those places. Because these are generally it is felt that these are the places where documents and goods will be kept, where you may have to inspect it. Even the stock checking also can be done in inspection, but you cannot verify whether this stock is actually the declared stock or go into intrusively open all the stocks and all those things. That is, it's like a slightly softer version. That's it. So it is, again, as you all know, it is like, it's a, when only evasion tax has taken place or not, you have to find it. Okay, if inspection leads to a reason to believe, this is a very legal jargon, reason to believe. Reasonable belief and reason to believe is a legal jargon, which means it is not a suspicion. It is something more than a suspicion. Suspicion can be that you think that this person might be doing a mistake, or this dealer may be doing a mistake, or this unit may be doing a mistake. But it is a little bit deeper version where you have evidence for the mistake to happen. Okay, this reason to believe can be recorded, but need not necessarily be recorded in file or any paper or anything. It is enough that in your if there is a counter to you in a court that you don't have any reason to believe, if you are able to produce the evidence in court, that is sufficient for you actually. That is the reason to believe concept here. Reason to believe is a very legal term, and it is used in central VAT very frequently as far as search is concerned. If inspection leads to a reason to believe that goods are liable to confiscation or documents relevant, it can be converted into a search. Still, this search has to be under a search warrant of a joint commissioner. So if you get a writing for inspection from a joint commissioner, you can do inspection. Probably if the joint commissioner is in the same location, you may send somebody, get a signature of a search warrant and convert that inspection into a search. This is one of the provisions. But good thing here is that search is more invasive. Like I told you, search warrant can be issued if the joint commissioner has reasons to believe pursuant to an inspection or otherwise. Which means not necessarily inspection is a precondition for a search. Even if you have other evidence that's substantial and joint commissioner has reasons to believe based on the evidence that is held in hand, she or he can issue a search warrant straight away. And we can do any confiscation of goods, documents, or do search of the place. Inspection is more like access to premises. There need not be a record created for inspection personally, actually. But all these mahaja proceedings will come for a search properly, because we don't seize goods in a inspection. or we don't need even a witness. We don't need a witness also for inspection actually. Listen, we'll show the letter and we'll tell that you give me a letter in this way that you have this document, you will be coming in this day. Exactly, surprise visit kind of thing. The joint commissioner here is both SGST and CGST joint commissioner rank officer. It is because right now currently search warrant is being issued even in central law, in service tax and in excise by joint commissioner or additional commissioner. Now there is a provision in the rules it will be given, they can be doing, there's a provision again given. Only condition again, if it is a residential premise, a woman officer should be coming with you without fail, for even if there is no woman officer in the woman, women in the residence. And that is why they give at last any place. They give business place and everything, at last one word will be given any place. So it will include the residence portion also. So if there is a need to force open, there is a provision in the criminal procedure code, you can force open a place and do it. If necessary, if you are not allowed access to a premise which you cannot break open, then for them also not to break open the place, you can actually seal the premise and come out. So later on you can make correspondence with the court to force them to open the place and go inside also. So there is no harm in breaking open. But it should be again recorded in the Mahasar, as I told, properly recorded in the Mahasar that the access was denied by this person specifically in this time, that how did he deny it and how were you forced to open it because you feel that this is the particular thing, it was opened actually. So there are certain safeguards to be done during search. So a normal search leads to seizure of at least documents in terms of services and in terms of sale of goods or anything, you even seize goods also. That happens normally. So whenever a seizure is happening, seized goods or documents should not be retained beyond period necessary for examination. So here it has been kept for 60 days. Within 60 days, if the notice for that particular contravention has not been issued to the person, then you may have to return the seized goods to the person. But it can be extended for 60 days each time up to a period of 6 months by a competent authority. The competent authority will be described again in a law later on. But that has not been told till now. But for sure, it should be above rank of a joint commissioner in legal sense because joint commissioner authorized the search. So it should be at least above the rank of a joint commissioner officer. So only for 60 days each time you can get extension up to a maximum period of 6 months after the initial 60 days. So effectively, it is 240 days that you can retain a good. After that, you may have to return it without fail. This is how it is told here. And sorry, the 60. Plus 6 months, yes sir. 60 days plus 6 months later on, sir.
Is there any change regarding the present rules of having
witnesses or not? No, there's no change. Everything is under, actually all this, good thing about this one is, it is not just about the earlier law of VAT or earlier law of SenVAT. It is about the Criminal Procedure Code, IPC and the judicial pronouncement of Supreme Court which are being followed. So necessarily there will not be effectively any change, but the person authorizing you or the number of days, those things can be changed here and there. That's it. The procedure should always be same because principles of natural justice should appear to have been followed at least. So, yes, it's clear in the act. Sir. Probably in the definition, here it is not clear, but 60 plus 6 months actually, sir. Yes, sir, that is clear. Sir. Photocopies of documents also should be provided to the person from you have taken up, and inventory should be done by the seizing officer, whoever is doing it, and it should be signed by the person who is in possession of the documents also earlier. Then certain goods like perishable and hazardous goods must be disposed as described in model GST rules. GST will be specifying rules how to dispose of goods in these terms, either by auction or by burning or by total condemnation. Then there's only one important change here. During a search, when all the records, whatever records you have made, has to be, as per criminal procedure code, has to be produced to a magistrate. Here the term magistrate should be read in the criminal procedure code for our purposes as a principal commissioner or commissioner of CGST or SGST, wherever we do the search. So all the records have to be, once you do a search and once you do all the seizure and all, the records should be placed before him at least once that you have seized and done these things. See, those modalities have to be worked out. Even if what happened is last you will be seeing an officer who is nominated to do the work of it. A CGST officer will also be empowered to do a SGST work, and SGST officer will also be empowered to do a CGST work. So in terms, you are doing a search of a particular premise in SGST, and you find that there is a possibly, if there is SGST evasion, there should be a CGST evasion also. So then what will happen is you will do all the preliminary works and then hand over the case to the CGST officers And at the time of search, you will be empowered to do the work as a CGST officer. There is no harm in that actually. So certain basic requirements that you all know should be followed. This is not specifically prescribed in the model GST law. It is just the principles laid down by various judicial pronouncements. And yes. There is no provisional release provision. Yeah, it has to be given in 60 days or 6 months, after that 6 months. That's it. There is no provisional release concept here. That is not provided in the Act. Probably it may be given in the law later on by a bylaw or something like that, but it is not correctly in the Act right now. What we envisage is, as for documents is concerned, he can take it as a Xerox copy, photocopy of that, but not any other thing. That's the thing about it. Yes, please. That is a concept of dual control, which is still being discussed in another council. But effectively, yes, there should be two show cause notices. Because there are two authorities involved in it, effectively there should be two show cause notices. So parallelly, two investigations should be going on. Yeah, it should be going on. But it's quite possible that in the dual control and whatever law recommendations coming from the dual control committee, they may suggest otherwise, that one particular person do for the entire thing if he takes up, something like that. We're not sure about it, that has not been settled. That's what it has to happen. That is the problem that we're still facing. Even for that matter, even a normal adjudication also, we'll have two proceedings. Even if you go by normal demand, demand under Section 51 of CGST Act will also imply that there is a demand under Section 51 of SGST Act. Okay, so there should be two proceedings he will have to follow for a particular transaction. That is a problem that right now they're not worked out the modalities of how to solve that yet, but it will soon be solved. That when the recommendations come out, you will be more clear about those things. Yeah, that is what they will not allow that to happen is what the idea is. They will probably give it to a particular person who started it. We're not sure about the model. They will give a clear procedure about it, because see, these are initial hiccups which we will start with. As an act becomes stabilized and act becomes, we start implementing, it will become more and more clear as to how to proceed with it. That is why it is envisaged that this training has happened together with for both central and state officers, because the coordination has to improve. It is not just for the learning of this act, but to know each other better and to know each other personally also. That is why we have been put up together. So later on, there will be requirement for a lot of coordination in the fields, because without coordination, I don't think GST can ever work. This is what the idea is. So these are the conditions. That should be a proper warrant, search warrant issued by a joint commissioner. Then there should invariably be a lady officer if there is a search of house residence. An officer before starting the search should disclose their identity by showing the identity cards. I mean, I'm not sure whether all of you will do it or not, but at least it should appear that it should be done. In the mahasar, please mention that you have shown the ID cards to the person you offered for personal search of a person, and the two witnesses are independent, reputed high habitants of the place. Probably, I think the drivers of the cars, of hired cars, will be the search. But still, it must be told that they are two reputed drivers of the place, actually. Then, presence of at least two independent witnesses should be there, and there should be signatures. When you're executing search warrant, is very important. When a person who is going to search, after introducing himself, should tell that he has been authorized by which provision of the act and by which officer to search the premises, and get the signature of the person who is accepting that this premises can be searched. This is very important for executing a search warrant. Once this has been done, the two witnesses who you are calling for signing the panchnama should also sign the this one, because witnesses are expected to be from the first initiation of search to the end of search. Okay, but normally what happens, I don't know about this one, but I don't know whether I can tell it also, but normally it may be at the last you call some person, ask him to sign and go. That is a different issue, but at least in paper it should not appear as such. Okay, it should be there. And the officers who are accompanying the searching officer, probably search warrant is given, and always search warrant is given only one person's name, but the officer who is accompanying the searching officer should sign at the back of the search warrant. And the search warrant should be given back to the issuing authority. This one is both. You have to offer for personal search. Before and after the search, you have to go and tell them that I have not stolen any of your goods, I have not secreted any of your documents, so you please search me before and after. Like that. Then a panchnama should be drawn very clearly, panchnama or mahasar, with all documents seized. A separate annexure should be made for seized documents. An inventory of seized documents has to be maintained separately, because this inventory will be placed before the commissioner or the joint commissioner as per the CRPC actually. Once the, after, then it should be actually given back to the issuing authority. The search warrant should be returned back to, after the executed search warrant should be returned back to the issuing authority. The issuing authority should maintain a register how much has been issued and which date it has been issued and all those things. And a copy of the panchnama should be given to the person in charge, the owner of the premises which was searched. It is given. This is one provision which is slightly different from the current existing law, I think. When goods are in movement, if the value of the goods is in any consignment of goods is more than 50,000 rupees, then the person in charge of the conveyance, the driver or the person, bus or whatever it is, should be having a document that is prescribed, that will be prescribed under model GST rules. The documents are not prescribed under the Act. Whatever documents are prescribed, probably a consignment note, the delivery voucher, whatever it is being there, it should be kept with him. And whenever asked by a officer of GST, CGST or SGST, he should produce it on demand without fail. This is for a consignment more than 50,000 rupees. To put it easily for you, if a particular truck has got some, say, 10 consignments of goods going to 10 people, sent by 10 other people, if each of those goods are lesser than 50,000 rupees, then he need not necessarily carry the documents that is prescribed under rules. But if a particular consignment, if a 10 consignments are there, one consignment is more than 50,000 rupees, then he has to carry those documents. Yeah. That is why it's given inspection of goods in movement. But you cannot charge a person of carrying unlawful goods if it is less than a value of 50,000 rupees, because it could be for any purpose. That is the idea about it. Probably the invoice should also be in hand. That's what documents. Yeah. I agree to it totally. I agree. Value should be arrived probably based on the invoice, whatever is being given. The document will be prescribed in model GST rule. Probably the invoice from a sender to receiver should. Then you have to leave it, ma'am. That's it. That is why we are as officers here. If you are undervaluing it, then probably you may have to issue a notice to him telling this particular good is undervalued later on. But because normally we accept transaction, thing is the valuation here in GST is a transaction value. So whatever is given in the invoice is accepted as the value in general. Okay. So if the invoice value is undervalued, then you may have to issue a notice to him to tell that your valuation is wrong, based on the valuation rules that is told by Nagendra Kumar sir the other day. So if you feel that this particular consignment is undervalued, you may not do anything that time, but once you know where it is going, so probably you may have to inform the person who is receiving the goods that this goods is undervalued, so you please take action on that, actually. Which one? No, if you, that's what, you cannot do it. That is how it is, ma'am. It is effectively made that people who is carrying normal goods, if one or two goods, like say, if we assume bogus people, we are right now in the mode of liberalization where we allow everybody to declare it properly, self-assessment. If they assess wrongly, it's up to us to do it in audit or preventive action. And this particular action is only to stop people from carrying goods of higher quantity and without proper documents. Let's say, for example, sir, a person is going for Diwali to purchase crackers to any border state or something, because that it will be lesser. Let's say Sivagasi. He goes to Sivagasi to purchase this one. And he pays 10,000 rupees this one and brings it across India. It's not necessary that he should have all the documents, because he just purchases for personal consumption. That is the idea behind it. But yes, practical difficulties are numerous in this one, and that's what I was telling. As far as this topic is concerned of search, seizure and arrest, it's more about improvisation on the field rather than what is given in the Act and the rules. It's about your intellect and innovativeness to implement it properly. This is what the provision is given, but if you want to improvise, that undervaluation is there. If you can prove it at that moment itself, well and good. It's up to the person in the search team or the inspection team to improvise on the Act, whatever it is there actually. Because all these things are given in law, sir. If you strictly want to follow all these things, I don't think you will ever do a search, or you will never do a seizure, or for that matter, even an arrest. Yes. Yes. Yes.
So in that, we detect most of the offences through this vehicle
Okay, sir. So then probably. Probably, maybe, sir. I'm not very very sure about the what's happening in VAT law, but we don't have my provisions to intervene a consignment personally and do it.
The value of consignment that can include the document is 5,000.
Okay, so probably they've increased the limit to 50,000 rupees because we have to go. We're going in a more liberalized mode than what was in the. Sir, if that is what is there now, right? No, 5,000 you're telling. Then you can do it into 100 consignment and still do it actually, no, sir. Effectively, it is like that actually. I'm not telling it is wrong, but a 5 lakh consignment can be divided into 100 consignment and still be moved without any document in 5,000 rupees.
That's not so easy.
Similarly, we are not, that is what I'm telling you. It is not so easy, but right now we are going in a liberalization mode, not in a control mode where we have to be in control of everything. We are believing that people will be doing good because we have got checks everywhere to check up the value. Because a person is undervaluing, probably he may have to take less credit for it. We are giving a seamless flow of credit. No, no, each consignment actually. The consignment is a particular. If we can 10 consignments, if a particular consignment has got more than 50,000 rupees, he has to have documents. No. I am very clear about this provision, sir. This provision, if you read the materials given to you, in the background material, they have clearly explained that it is each consignment has to be over and above 50,000 rupees to have the document to be carried. If there are 10 consignments going in a particular truck and they don't have 50,000 rupees value, they need not carry document at all. But all the, all yes sir. No, not necessarily actually. Consignor to a consignee actually. See, it's from me to you. It's a, yes sir. Yeah. No. That is what I'm telling you, sir. It is, they can carry how much ever goods they want to carry. It does not, no, that's what, without documents, if they have to carry, then what I'm telling you, sir, if it is from me to you, I am only, that it is from me to you, then that is a particular consignment. That has to be less than 50,000 rupees.
Because you just mentioned,
yes, sir.
Somebody is making, in a world there are five bundles.
Okay.
Each worth around 45 lakh.
Bundles and consignments are not same, actually, sir.
Fine,
it will be a different consignment then. Because it's addressed from one person to five different people.
Yeah.
So it will be five different consignments. Yeah, they can do it. No, right now your limit, sir, what sir was telling to me, I understand, is 5,000 rupees. That has been increased to 50,000 rupees. That is the only thing. Because of the nature of transactions, we think. Okay. But this here, they have linked it to consignment. I'm not sure about what VAT law tells us. But here it is very clear that it is linked to consignment wise and 50,000 rupees. Okay, but if a person has to evade, he, yes, sir, please. Yes. Yes, sir, but the credit will be for 100 different people, na?
Yeah.
So a fellow will not want to give that consignment to 100 different people because he will lose out on the credit, actually.
Yes, sir, if it is a consumer,
what will be the person? Yeah, fair enough.
If 100 persons are consuming,
it's not really the fair enough, he cannot, he need not carry those documents, that's it. He need not carry those documents, necessarily. That's it, sir. Because anyhow, you have a limit of more than 2,50,000 rupees, you have to. It is specifically below, the exception, that's why I was like cracker example. He goes and buys a cracker and comes, then he doesn't want to show documents for each and every time. That is the thing actually about it, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah. That is why we are being informed early, so we have to be ready for the challenge. Yes, please. Yes. Yes, sir.
In such a case, if there is no invoice,
yes,
how can we find out in which states it will follow
in? No, that concern, that is what I am telling, sir. The particular document has to be still, document is still, yes, sir.
The consignment is not accompanied by any document.
Yes.
Without document, up to 50,000 we can transport. So, how can the consumer, to which states it relates, and at what extent, how can it be distributed to the concerned state there?
Sir,
if the destination point tax is the basis of that,
sir,
how it is possible there?
Yeah, this is only for check inspection and goods in movement. The document is still prescribed. He still, if he has to sell from one person to another person, he may not carry the invoice with him. But the invoice is still to be issued by the outward supplier. He cannot tell that I will not issue an invoice, I will not invoice it for less than 50,000 rupees. He has to invoice it for less than 50,000 rupees. But he need not necessarily carry it with the goods. That is the only thing I am speaking about. It is, he still has to invoice it. The goods have to be still, proper documentation has to be followed. Only thing, need not necessarily carry it with this one. If he carries it, well and good. Sir, right now what we are envisaging is that the credit is seamless flow. So we are allowing every credit to be taken almost except for this one. So if a particular fellow is not, is undervaluing it, the loss is for him rather than for the department actually. If he is showing an invoice value of this much, do it. If we really have a problem with this valuation, by similar products having higher value and this fellow has a lower value, then obviously there's chance for you to take under demand under Section 51 by proving that it is undervalued, sir. There's no problem about that. Yeah, exactly. You don't have to. It is like to reduce checks as much as possible is what has been envisaged, because we are going into liberalisation mode than the control mode. More record-based control, exactly. This provision is actually new to the state VAT authorities completely, which we have in our central VAT arrest. In central VAT currently, we have collected and not paid and certain kinds of offences, only those can be, evasion in those things can be arrested and above certain amount of rupees. Here also it has been given, arrest can be done by, under order, if the commissioner has reasons to believe. Again, I told you, reasons to believe is a very legal jargon. Does not necessarily mean that a suspicion, but there has to be substantial evidence that there is an evasion that has happened actually. The commissioner of GST or CGST or SGST has a reason to believe, he can authorize any officer of his to arrest a particular person, okay, provided he commits an attracts a punishment under 73.12 or 73.2. These are 73.12 is effectively it means that if a person is evading tax of 50,000 rupees to 2.5 crores, 50 lakh rupees to 2.5 crores. If evasion is in the tune of 50 lakh rupees to 2.5 crores, that is 73.11. And 73.12 is if he is evading more than 2.5 crores. And 73.2 is if he is a repeated offender. So this 73.12, which we still, if the evasion of duty is more than 2.5 crores, that is what we call as cognizable and non-bailable offence. Rest everything are bailable and non-cognizable offences, right? So there are certain safeguards prescribed for arrest. That means, as you all know, it is in the criminal CRPC is clearly mentioned it, and I very clearly that you have to produce a person if you have arrested him under for an offence which is non-bailable and cognizable. He has to be produced before a magistrate within 24 hours of the arrest being made. For arrest to be made, sir, actually there should be a touch happening at least. You should confine the person physically. So if I am going to arrest, sir, I will go and tell you are under arrest. Without that, arrest cannot happen. If you tell that you are under arrest orally, arrest cannot happen. This is the CRPC rule tells this. A confinement or a touch has to happen there. At least physical light touch also has to happen there. If he resist arrest, you can always use exclusive force or excessive force for doing it. But generally, if he is surrendering, even then you may have to touch him until you are under arrest. Only then arrest is effected. If a person is arrested for a cognizable offense, he must be informed of arrest in the writing of grounds of arrest. Whatever is the reason to believe for the commissioner should be informed to him that this is the reason that we have believed that you are supposed to be arrested. So that should be given to him in writing, and he should be produced before a judicial magistrate within 24 hours of his arrest. This 24 hours will not include the time that is taken from the place of arrest to the place of the magistrate. That will be excluded from this 24 hours. And if a person is arrested for a non-cognizable and bailable offence, then the deputy commissioner or assistant commissioner can release him on bail. This is mainly because in CRPC we have a provision that for same kind of offences, a police officer in charge will be giving him bail automatically. That is why we have incorporated this also, that deputy commissioner or assistant commissioner can give him bail. But provided certain, he can also impose certain conditions. Conditional bails will be there. For example, he has to give a surety or a person of repute will come and kind of security for him, and all those conditions that he has to be coming to his office whenever called for, he should not leave the country. Those conditions, those type of conditions will still continue. There is no harm in doing those conditions. Only thing is that he cannot deny a bail to him. Denying a bail is not an option in the case of bailable offence. He has to give a bail, but if the conditions of the bail are not followed, it is his problem that he will still be arrested and put in this one. Once the conditions of the bail are not followed, he will be again produced within 24 hours of the violation of the bail conditions to the magistrate, and he will be taken to this one. The magistrate in this one will be a judicial magistrate. all arrests must be in provisions of in relation to provisions of criminal code of conduct. That is a normal criminal procedure code. This is what we have just explained to you. Cognizable offense is anything that is tax evasion over and above 2.5 crores. All other offenses are non-cognizable. Simple, it's defined that way. Yeah, 2 crores it is there actually. Yes. We are changing it from that provision, we are moving it into this one actually. It is going to be 2.5 crores for this is the difference you see. You can still arrest a person less than 2.5 crores also. Only thing is that you have to release him immediately on bail on some conditions. That's it. Arrest is arrest always, and you can always deter him from that. But our practical experience of arrest tells that once arrest is made, you can rarely recover anything from him. That is his maximum. You arrested me, so what? No, nothing more to be done. You don't have to pay anything. You don't have to give me anything. I will not pay anything. He will tell and go. So that is the practical experience of arrest. But yes, there is quite a chance that there are few people who, on once arrested, they are very scared, and the son or daughter who runs the business will immediately come and pay the money and tell that, so now we have paid, please do it. The incidents of both have happened, but majorly it is very, arrest can be extreme provision. You try to keep it as the extreme measure. Don't use it with full force immediately now and then, because at the end of the day, for us, what matters is recovery. If recovery doesn't come, there is no use that we are arresting a person also, actually. Arrest is actually deterrent for others of the same kind not to follow the same thing. That is the main idea about it. Yeah. The idea behind this one is that the person who will be authorized to arrest itself will be assistant commissioner or deputy commissioner. Not a CTO or a superintendent will be authorized to do it, because arrest is an extreme provision where you may have to face even high court writ petitions against you because you have made the arrest. So you should be careful enough to do it. It's a very cautious provision. You cannot do it for anybody, authorize it for anybody. So the idea is that it will be authorized to a assistant commissioner or deputy commissioner. That is the idea behind it actually. So because arresting you actually violate Article 21 of the person to freedom to move actually. So once you do that, it's quite possible he will straight go to writ petition, not to a subject or a judge where you are producing him. He will go to High Court, he will tell that my right to freedom of movement has been restricted by these authorities for no reason of mine. That is why the reasons to believe in writing has to be given to him also. The reasons to believe will also, that is why I was explaining at that time, reasons to believe is not mere suspicion. There's a proper evidence has to be there for reasons to believe. And the reason to, it may not be recorded in writing in your file, but you must have the evidences on record, because other than that, you will be in trouble if you arrest him without the reason to believe. And I'm pretty sure it's been, the power has been given in our law, both for, normally in, yes, please. No, need not necessarily record it on file, because if you record it on file, it may be, information may be leaked out. That's it. If you have particular, but over a poor person, we can go and convince also. If investigation doesn't happen over file every time. See, I right now sit in Kochi, but my commissioner and my joint commissioner sit in Bangalore. I go regularly to convince them that this is a case, please do give me a search warrant or something. I cannot get a search warrant over fax also. I have to get it in hand. I have to go there and only get and come. That is how it happens. But it is envisaged that it will be state-wise, so everybody can move within the state a little bit easier and do it. In investigation, not everything happens in file, and you don't write everything in file. Because by mistake, if the file gets misplaced or anything, every information goes out and investigation is lost, that is gone forever then. Evidence is gone forever. So you have evidence on record, you prove it to your commissioner in person that this is the reason I have. If you want, I'll give a Xerox copy to you also, sir. You please do it. That is why the, in some criminal procedure code, only bailable offenses, non-bailable offenses need the permission of a magistrate to arrest. Bailable offenses. Non-bailable offenses need not have a, like a murder or a rape or anything, need not have a magistrate's permission to arrest an accused or a suspect. But here in our law, we have told that both cognizable and non-cognizable has to have a permission in writing from the commissioner to have arrest. That is why the permission to arrest has been given at a very higher rank officer, because he will take due diligence and he will have proper reason to believe that arrest is being made, not by anybody else. If you give it to an assistant commissioner or a deputy commissioner, he is in the field. So he will have a heat of a moment argument with somebody, and he may be angry, I will arrest you for this one. He may go and arrest the person even without a reason to believe. That is why it's given to a very higher rank officer who will actually make due diligence before using his powers of arrest. That is the idea behind it. Not necessarily. Not necessarily. Even right now, when violation happens in service tax also, when a violation, if it collects more than 2.5, you don't arrest in every case. You try to arrest, but then the commissioner has to give you permission to arrest, because some violation may happen not because of individual intent or anything like that. It can be any reason for that matter. Not necessarily arrest has to be made in every case more than 2.5 crores or 50 lakhs for that matter. That means everybody will be in jail not doing business. You will not have any revenue from that moment actually. But that is why it is given at the level of commissioner. If you feel that it is to be arrested, you have to put it before the commissioner or the principal commissioner, and they will tell you, no, it is not a case for arrest, this is a case for arrest. That's the idea. Yeah, what I'm telling is evaded, we have a attempted to be evaded, I don't understand, attempted to be evaded because...
Can you report that the actual amount has been evaded at
testing? Sir, for example, sir, let us assume there is a case where he has made a supply, you have proof that he has made a supply.
That is why the specific amount attempted to be evaded has been included.
Okay. No, no, what happens here is that if you have a... here what idea is, sir, if you make a supply and you don't record it, but that has come to your notice, or let us say for that matter, sir, you take a credit, which is for, let us say, a motor vehicle used for transportation, which is a capital good, but you have not taken depreciation. You have not included the depreciation amount, you are taking credit also, you are taking depreciation income tax also. If all those kind of credit issues also will be there. This tax evasion includes credit violation. Yeah, here there will not be a case of collector and not paid, because yesterday I told you there should be a valid return to take credit. So the moment he doesn't pay a tax, the credit will be denied at the other side. So there will not be not much case of collected but not paid, because the return provision tells that there should be a valid return. It is, you have to pay a tax before you are getting credit for that. Mostly it is clandestine or removal without documents and credit issues, all those things. I think so, sir. I think it can be considered tax evaded because the person has not paid tax.
After, he might be able to prove that he has not evaded tax. Then that's a contingency.
Okay, probably legal problem may happen.
The activity made against the suspicion.
Yeah.
That's
what, actually in central VAT law, what we tell is when you issue a notice, you still suspect only. But you have substantial evidence to prove that it has been done. So it is still a suspicion only, it is not a proof. A proof will happen only after the adjudication authority. So the evidence is what I think will be believed. That is why it has not been kept, is what I believe so, sir, actually. Because that is why reasons to believe will not be there. You have to have substantial evidence for that. That is why. But one thing, let us all keep it in mind. Yes, sir. Yeah. Nobody will issue a warrant actually. Now one important thing what we have to keep in mind here is that arrest is the extreme provision of law that you are going to use. It's not going to be a day-to-day affair that you are going to do it. So we have had arrest provisions for the last 4-5 years actually right now, sir. And probably the whole department must have made a total of 100 arrests put together, I think. Not more than that. Total in 5 years in the entire India country we have made 100 to 150 arrests maximum. That is what has happened, not much more than that. Because the reason is that it is an extreme measure where you do only in condition where there is no other chance but to do it, to deter him from doing the evasion. That kind of things actually, sir. So, here, that's what I was explaining you, there is a chance of making an arrest without a warrant for a person in police. But we don't have an opportunity here, we have to get a writing or written order from the commissioner to make an arrest. Other than that, you cannot make. Yeah, commissioner must authorize a particular officer to make the arrest. The officer who is authorized to make the arrest must be in there, and there are some conditions given in DK Basu case, which will be explained later. That how should you follow? What are the conditions to do? Like you have to go and you have to have a clear badge telling that what is your name and all those things. There are some conditions prescribed. Before making arrest, there should, as in CBSE, we have had slight experience of arresting people. These are the things properly to be done. Please make sure the investigation is proper. If the investigation is slightly botched in any place and you arrest a person, you are in soup. It's 100% sure you will be in jail, no matter what actually. That is how it's going to be, because you are actually restricting a person's movement. So you must be 100% sure that person has evaded and without doing it. And we have had experience that we will never touch a person where we have doubt. In central VAT law, at least we have tried that. We have never ever tried to arrest a person. Even when we know that the person has evaded it, we would make it 100% doubly sure that before making arrest that the person is pakka. We have a pakka evidence to do it. Otherwise, we will not touch it. Even though there are cases where evasion is about 25 crores, they have paid the 25 crores that is collected, but still we don't have evidence to pinpoint a particular person as being reason for that evasion of 25 crores, we don't arrest that person. He may be the managing director, he may be the manager, or he may be the finance accountant, whatever it is. He may be the person who has caused it, but if you don't have evidence for that particular person being involved in this violation, you don't make an arrest of this one. To prevent such person from absconding, you have to be careful about doing all these things. These are the reasons why you do it. Preventing possibility of tampering with evidence, intimidating of influencing witnesses, all those things. Here, this is the landmark judgment regarding, this is a landmark judgment which has been clearly, which has clearly described what are the procedures to be followed before making an arrest, or what is the precautions you have to take during an arrest. Only then you can tell that I have not made an arrest hastily, or I have not made an arrest without any, by using illegal means. You can tell that arrest is a legal means only if you follow these procedures. An officer carrying out arrest and handling interrogation of the arrestee should bear accurate, visible and clear indication and name tags with their designations. It is a very important thing because the person who is being arrested must know that who is arresting him, whether it is an authorized person to arrest or not. Similarly, so particulars of such all such officials who handle interrogation of the arrestee must be recorded in a register. There is always an arrest register in an investigating organization. Similarly, it should be maintained in the commissionerate where commissioner is giving the respond. The officer carrying out the arrest shall prepare a memo of arrest at the time of arrest. Memo of arrest is a document which includes all the details like who you are going to arrest and what is the evidence that is available, gist of evidence, not exactly the complete gist, and who is authorized you to make the arrest, which time you are doing the arrest, all those details you have to do it and you have to show him also that one. Such memo shall be attested by at least one witness, either a member of the family of the arrestee or a respectable person of the locality from where the arrest is made. Okay, arrest also needs a witness. But there need not be two witnesses, there can be one witness for arrest. Arrest memo should be countersigned by the arrestee, the person who is being arrested, and must contain the time and date of arrest without fail. Arrest memo is, there's no specific restriction as to what are the details should be in arrest, but there's a broad indication as to what should be in arrest memo. So it is better you use all those, whatever indications have been given in arrest memo, and what more you think, because normally all arrests are not similar. One arrest may be very smooth, another arrest may be very resistive. So you have to use your own intellectual innovativeness to actually draft an arrest memo or whatever it is to show that you have done everything legally possible in the best way. A person who has been arrested or detained shall be entitled to have one friend or relative or other person known to him or having interest in his welfare being informed as soon as practicable that he has been arrested and is being detained at the particular place. Okay, this is a very important right for him because unless until he informs a friend, the arrest is not legal. You have to inform somebody about it. The good thing is that if this person who is attesting the memo itself is a friend or a family, then you may not need separate intimation in record. Because already the arrest memo itself has got a person who has intimated, who's been intimated, so you need not separately intimate him about that arrest. This is probably a D.K. Basu case, 97, one first volume, so 96 end it must have been issued. So telegraphically and all those words have been used, which may not be this one. This is not in the law, it's just a procedure prescribed by Supreme Court, so you can almost follow it in the current scenario by whatever record means you have. The entry must be made in the diary of at the place of detention regarding arrest of a person. Entry must also disclose the name of the next friend of the person who has been informed of the arrest and the names and particulars of the police officials in whose custody the arrestee is. This is police because the court pronounced it for the police arrest. It will be our custody if we take it. Again, in here we can make sure that the arrest can be, when the person arrested, his custody can be given to a police also. If you want, you can go and give it to him to a police station, provided there is a proper challan made in the police station and proper registers being done. If you don't have proper place to detain him. If you have a place and if you take responsibility that you will not allow this person to escape from your response for 24 hours, you can always hold a place as a detention place and you can make that place as a, in the arrest memo, you can make that place as the place of detention and you can do it. It's up to you. But you can still use the help of a police station if you feel that you don't have a proper place to detain him. The arrestee should also be taken to a medical examination that you know for major or minor injuries at every time. Actually, effectively, it is every 48 hours it should be If you detain him for more than 48 hours, every 48 hours he should be subjected to a medical examination. This medical examination is by either by a state or central government medical practitioner. If both are not available in a particular place of arrest that you have made, is there any recognized medical practitioner should be used, one of these people. And if the person arrested is a lady, the doctor should be a female doctor. Whoever it is, the central government, state government, or recognized medical practitioner, it should be a female doctor if a person arrested is a this one. The inspection memo must be signed both by the arrestee and the police officer effecting the arrest, and its copy provided to the arrestee. This inspection memo probably is the arrest memo. They have used the wrong word in this one. The arrestee should be subjected to, I was telling, every 48 hours he should be given. And copies of all the documents, including the memo of arrest referred to above, should be sent to the magistrate for his record. So whatever the arrest memo, whatever documents you, evidences you have provided, everything should be going to the magistrate to convince him that the arrest is warranted. The arrestee may be permitted to meet his lawyer during interrogation, though not throughout the interrogation. Because any lawyer, when you are doing interrogation, if it's close by, he'll disturb your whole interrogation. So that is the idea behind it. But still, he must be allowed to meet him before, let's say, for example, you put a question and he wants to answer it, but he, after a consultation with the lawyer, you can always allow that to happen. But that will happen in front of us only, but still that can happen. And the lawyer can be sent out and he can be made to reply the question that we've asked for. So arrest is over. So that is the this one. Remaining things are almost all same with you. Powers to summon is also there. It's still continuing under section 63. This section gives powers to a duly authorized CGST or SGST officer to call upon a person by issuing a summon to present himself before for giving evidence or producing documents or any other thing in any inquiry which an officer is making. Which means this word any other thing is a very good term. So you can ask him to produce anything, you can ask him to show any detail, even a, let us say a cell phone also can be a thing. You can ask him to do show anything for that if he comes in summon. That also is provided, it's provided, but that authorized, I'll explain that. A summon to produce documents or other things may be for production of certain specified documents or things, or for production of all documents or things of certain description in possession or under control of the person summoned. It's almost the same thing that has been repeated here. A person who is summoned can legally appear himself or through an authorized representative, provided the appearance by authorized representative is allowed by the summoning officer. The summoning officer should allow that, okay, you can, an authorized representative of yours can come. That is there. And it must be noted that the officer has discretion to summon the person himself or allow a person to be represented. This should, there are exemptions under 132 and 133. This is explained here. 132 is like women who, according to their customs and traditions, are not allowed to appear in front of a person before, then they need not appear in person, but they can appear through an authorized representative, or the vice president, government, president, chief minister, or they can appear through an authorized representative if you feel that they have violated this one. All these exemptions will apply in respect of summons issued under CGST and SGST Act. Both acts will be there. A person summoned is bound to state the truth before the officer who has issued the summon upon any subject respecting which they are examined or makes statements and produce such documents and other things as may be required. This bound to say the truth actually is because the Indian Penal Code tells that if there is a false statement given before an officer who is recording a statement on a summon, then that will be penalized under the Indian Penal Code. And similarly, if we are obstructing or intervening an officer recording a statement or getting evidence from you, then even that is punishable under Indian Penal Code. That is what is mentioned in 193 and 228. The judicial proceeding means this both things should not happen. There should be a truth when always you told, like when you go to a judicial proceeding, proper judicial proceeding in court, they always keep the hand on the Constitution of India and tell that they tell truth, something similar to that. These provisions of IPC can be invoked where the person is summoned and gives false evidence or interrupts the proceedings during summons. This is 193 and 228. This section 172, 174, and 175 of IPC 1860 are also relevant in respect of summon proceedings, because these are the three problems you will be facing in summon proceedings. When you summon, a person does not appear. What to do with him? That is also given here. Absconding to avoid service of summons or other proceedings. Okay? If he doesn't receive only for three times, there is a provision which you can take to magistrate, produce the evidences that you have summoned him three times, but all the three times he has absconded to evade receipt of summon. So you make him available to us. So a magistrate can order a police officer to make him available before you, to Detain him, bring it. It's not an arrest. It's that to make it available before you. Non-attendance in obedience to an order from public servant. This is the second part, where he receives the summon, but still doesn't appear. He receives it very promptly, signing perfectly, telling that, okay, I will do it. But all the three times he doesn't appear before you, you can still inform it to the magistrate, giving substantial proof that, sir, you please ask him to be produced in front of us by a police officer, or whatever means the magistrate thinks to be doing it. Omission to produce a document or electronic record to public servant by a person legally bound to produce it. This also can be done. Power to summon enables an officer to call a suspect or witness to give evidence or produce documents. This is important because he can call any person generally, but legally speaking, he can call any person, but there must also be a proof that he should be either a suspect or a witness in that case. Because there are some guidelines given by CBEC in terms of summons, which we'll be discussing later. Because you call any person, let us say for that matter, Reliance Industries, you have a case in Reliance Industries, you call Anil Ambani or Mukesh Ambani, you come down here, summon him. When that is not expected of you. You are expected to deal with the person who is actually doing the violation. Probably Anil Ambani does not go into daily transaction, or Mukesh Ambani doesn't go to daily transactions. You can call them, provided you have proof that they are directly involved in the violation. That is the idea about it. It's an important step in investigation which helps convert the findings to admissible evidence, because a statement in front of a tax officer, GST officer, is a evidence. A statement in front of a police officer is not an evidence. It's just a finding from the respondent. But if it is going to be evidence, it is evidence in front of you. If you record a statement and he admits a crime in the statement, it is going to be evidence in adjudication proceedings. The CBSE has issued some guidelines to summons. The same may be incorporated in the thing by way of a circular or instruction later. Summons to be issued as a last resort where assessee are not cooperating. This section should not be used for top management. This is the very thing. Because you call somebody just to meet a person. It's not fair actually, right? You may have a problem with Malayala Manorama paper. You want to meet the top management. You just call him. You cannot do that way. It should be reasonable. The language of summons should not be harsh and legal. This one is a very loaded term because you cannot be very soft, sir, please do come in front of me. That cannot be that term. It is generally like this, under section, so and so section, you are asked to appear before this officer at this place at this time. Okay. If a violation of this, you may be punishable under this sections of Indian Penal Code. This will be the normal term of use of a summon. That's it. But we need not use that if you don't do it, this may be the punishments for you. Detention by a police officer, bringing in front of you, those things need not be used. That is the whole idea about it. Let us keep it as simple as possible for a summons concern. Summons by superintendent should be issued by, this is in case of a directive of a CBC, so superintendent rank officer, whenever he is issuing summons, he should issue after obtaining prior permission of officer not below the rank of assistant commissioner or deputy commissioner, with reasons for issuance of summons to be recorded in writing. So normally when a summon is put to us, they have to issue summons, we have to see that at least, normally we have a procedure where we see at least three letters have been issued to him asking to produce the documents, asking to come in person or something. Letters, normal letters, without any quoting any legal jargons there. If that is not being done, if the three letters have been ignored even after receipt of those letters, then we resort to summons in our, this one. We recorded also that three letters have been issued, this person in these dates, and he has not appeared for us any reason, that's why we are issuing summons for this purpose. Where for operational reasons, it's not possible to obtain written permission, orally or telephonically you have to obtain permission, and it should be recorded in writing immediately as soon as possible. It should be brought down in written words. In all cases where summons are issued, the officer issuing summons should submit a report or should be record a brief of the proceedings in case file and submit the same to the officer who has authorized the issuance of summons. So if a deputy commissioner or a assistant commissioner issued authorization for issue of summons, then the summon issuing authority should produce to him a gist of the whole thing that happened during the summon proceedings to him. This is what it is given very clearly. Summons generally should not be issued to senior management unless until you see a CFO or a CEO or general managers of large companies or PSUs are directly involved in decision making which has led to the evasion of tax. If a particular, when you record a statement of a lawyer official, he tells that a CFO has taken this decision in this meeting, and the minutes of the meeting is submitted for you. You have proof that the minutes of the meeting are there, and the decision has been taken by the CFO, which has resulted in your loss of revenue, you can call him immediately. There's no harm in calling him. But you have to record it in writing and proof that you have called him only because the evidence shows that he is the one who has taken the decision, and that decision has led to the evasion of tax or loss of revenue to the government of India. So this is one has been Section 64 has been incorporated primarily due to a problem I think we are facing in Central VAT Administration. Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah, evidentiary value you are speaking, right? We does have it. A statement has evidentiary. That's what I was telling. Any statement recorded. Yeah, it has evidentiary value. As our court of law will be initial stages will be the departmental officers. When goes to Standard High Court, yes, it will be there. Yes, please. We have it have to have a backing. Yeah, that is true, sir. But if a person admits straight away that yes, I am doing this thing, and you, whatever evidences you have shown is correct, then it is evidence in straight away actually. Ah, that is right, sir. The reason for cross-examination will come because later a person can always retract a statement. He will come and tell, no, I gave it under coercion. If he retracts a statement in a court of law, there will be a problem. That is why you need to have a backing evidence to tell that whatever he has admitted is based on the evidence given to him. Not a conclusive evidence. It has an evidentiary value, but if he retracts it, he can still retract it. He has the right to retract it. You cannot tell he will not be able to retract it. He can retract it, but provided you show that these are the evidence I showed in front of him, based on this he accepted it. So it should be taken as evidence rather than the other statement which he retracted should not be taken as evidence. That is how you can show in adjudicating authority. Like that. This one is a problem we are facing in Central VAT Administration because in the Act per se, we have excise service tax or excise for that matter does not include access to a business premises. So Kolkata High Court has struck down, I think, that the audit of Central Excise and Service Tax is illegal. Delhi High Court has struck that it is illegal. Okay, because you don't have the right to access the business premises. How can you go and do an audit there? Audit in our terms is software compared to investigation. We only ask for certain records and do a risk-based audit. We do a risk disk review and ask for only certain documents which we are looking for, and we do an audit of those documents. So Delhi High Court has told that it is illegal. So what has happened right now is that is why we have tried to incorporate this. And I think based on the request of CAG also, sir, I think CAG has also been put into it because they also had a problem 2 years before, and they don't go to the premises anymore. They go for audit of the division through which they ask for the assessee's records, and effectively they do the same audit, but they cannot go to the premises of the assessee anymore actually. So that is why it has been brought in the Act itself here. This provision shall allow an audit party of CGST or SGST or CAG or a cost accountant or chartered accountant nominated under Section 50 of CGST or SGST Act access to any business premises without issuance of a search warrant. This is mainly because officer of additional commissioner or joint commissioner rank of CGST or SGST will authorize them in writing, and the letter will be given to that person, and in 15 days he has to give whatever documents called for, he has to produce them when they access the premises. There will be a time lag. So if the joint commissioner authorizes a particular person, he will issue a letter to the assessee telling that joint commissioner or additional commissioner authorized me for accessing your business premises on this particular day regarding these issues. So you may be providing these documents to me whenever I come there, on which date I come there. It must be at least 15 days. After 15 days, they should provide these documents to the officer visiting this one or even the CAG officer. And this two concept of cost accountant and chartered accountant, I'm not sure whether you have in VAT law, but we have it in our central laws, which is a separate audit. It's a special audit. We call it a special audit. It has been included as a cost accountant or a chartered accountant. When we feel that I think audit will be taken separately by somebody, they will explain it. But when we feel that some specific violation has happened and it includes some technical subject to be understood and very technically this person is evading, you think that this particular thing can be caught by a chartered accountant only, an officer of substantially high rank, in our case it is commissioner, can do or chief commissioner in certain cases can authorize a chartered accountant to visit the premises of a business premises and do audit of that person and submit a report to us, or a cost accountant for that matter. If you have a problem with valuation, you tell that. Yes, special audit, same, special audit only, but the state VAT doesn't have this provision, I think, till now. Yes, You have it? Okay. Okay, then it's okay. I was told in Karnataka that they don't have, so. Okay. No, the cost accountant and salary accountant you have? That is what I'm speaking about. The cost accountant and salary accountant is what I'm speaking about. Audit by tax officers is allowed, but cost accountant and salary accountant also is empowered now. Because some cost accountant has a certain specialization in doing some cost auditing, right? He can, if your valuation is, you are doubtful of a valuation, you can always authorize a cost accountant to go and do the cost auditing. He will go entirely check, give a report to you. It is all recommendary in nature. All the cost auditing and chartered accountants are recommendary in nature. You can either take up the, you can accept this findings or not accept this findings. It is up to the commissioner or the person authorizing it to accept or not accept it. But still, our practice is that we don't get good chartered accountants or cost accountants for doing that particular audit because payment is very delayed, first thing, and payment is not substantial as they expect it actually. Because all the chartered accountants and cost accountants charge heavily and that is not what is authorized by the government to pay. So normally we don't get good pool of people who do it actually. That is what is the experience here. Access is for the purposes of carrying out any audit, scrutiny, verification and checks as may be necessary to safeguard the interest of revenue. So it is not necessarily audit, it can be any scrutiny, verification and check also. But only thing here is that it need not have a search warrant, but you cannot do a search there. You can only ask for documents again there. It's another variation of inspection, like what can be told, but it need not necessarily be, not immediate. It should have a 15 days gap at least. So written authorization is still to be issued by an officer of the rank of additional commissioner or joint commissioner. This provision facilitates access to a business premises which is not registered by a taxable person as a principal or additional place of business but has book of accounts, documents, computers, etc. which are required for audit or verification of accounts of a taxable person. Yeah. That's there, no? Or no, no, special audit doesn't, what I'm telling is this provision gives access to business premises. See, audit of cost accountant and chartered accountant, there are limitations prescribed under audit section. That is a separate section. Somebody else will be taking it. I am just telling that the access to their business premises has been allowed in this law through this provision of section 64. Section 64 does not takes cover of a thing that if you cannot, SSC cannot tell that a visit to my premise by another person is illegal. He cannot take that. We can tell that by section 64, I have right to visit your premise. You cannot tell I am illegal. I am legally visiting your premise. Because right now we have a problem of all those audits in premises, that's why. This provision, the last one what you tell is that even if a particular business premise is not registered and if you have proof that it has got some documents, it can still be visited. This is up to us for interpretation whether it is required for search or for audit or anything. If it is available straight on record and you just can go and ask for the document, it's fine. But I have my own doubts because if a person is not registering his premises, and still has got book of accounts, there is no need he will produce to you. He may not necessarily produce to you. That has got this one, but if he produces, well and good. You can always take it for use. Upon demand by the proper officer or audit party or cost accountant or chartered accountant, so authorized, the person in charge of the premises will have to produce the records maintained by a registered taxable person at the said premises for his security scrutiny within a reasonable time. This within a reasonable time has been told us 15 working days. However, records must be produced within 15 working days of making the demand or such further extended period that may be allowed by the person who made the request for the documents. Okay? So 15 days is the maximum limit within which he can produce. So he can produce in 7 days, 8 days also. But if he wants the extension more than 15 days, he should ask in writing that he cannot produce in 15 days for so and so reason. So I want extension for so much days and I will be able to give it to you. So. This one, the following documents listed must be produced. You can trial balance, all these things are there, but the last word is more important, any other relevant document. So not necessarily it is restricted to the trial balance, the financial accounts, cost audit, income tax audit, or any register maintained. Any relevant document that you think is having with him, then you can do it. So this ends the business premises thing. Okay? This will actually help you in the question that I asked, like, you asked me whether CGST officer can do the work of SGST officer and all. This is what provision, it will be enabled again, once again, in the rules specifically. But here it is told that the following officers are required to assist the CGST or SGST officers. They don't have a right to deny it. If they are called upon, they have to assist. Okay, the officers are police, customs, officers of state, central government engaged in collection of GST, which means a state officer are calling upon a CGST officer, he cannot tell that I will not come and help you. He has to help him actually. And officer of state or central government engaged in collection of land revenue. I don't say central government land revenue, not much, but state government land revenue officers will have to help up. And all village officers, any other class of officers as may be notified by the central or state government. It will be clearly defined, it will be clearly defined in by notification who are supposed to report and what is supposed to be done by those people. How to call those people for help and all those things, it will be defined later. That's it. Any specific doubts? Okay, thank you.